This is one picture I have found on internet. Just see here. This is the shaft. This portion is the shaft, and this is hub. This is attachment of gear. We have a keyway here, and this keyway is external type. We can also have this type of keyway, two key. And in this part, this is the key. If we insert this key here, this lower portion of this key will be attached with this internal groove, and this outer portion will be attached with this portion. If this shaft rotates, or just say if this shaft rotates, this wall of shaft will exert force on this part, and this part starts to rotate with the shaft. While this part is rotating, its other end, just like this side, its other end is resisted by this surface. So there will be a force on that surface as well, and because this is a metallic part, it will not fail. We have to design it like this, so that the opposite side of this will exert force on this part, and this hub will also start to rotate. So that's the basic function of key. And why we put key? If there is excessive force, excessive torque on the shaft, or there is excessive resistance of the hub, or vice versa, there is excessive torque on hub and excessive resistance from this portion, there is a possibility that either this shaft or this hub fails. And as these components are expensive, we prefer a small or least expensive or cheap component to fail. So if the forces exceed, we design this such a way that this key fails in shear. It acts like a fuse. It saves as the fuse when the current is a lot, the amount of current is huge. The fuse burn itself and save the house. So that's in the same manner, if there is the torque is increased, this key fails and it saves other mechanical components. So that is the basic function of key. This topic I have taken from the book of Norton, because it is easy and it is very well written in that book as compared to Shigley. What is key and keyway? But the basic definition of key, according to ASME, is a demountable machinery part which, when assembled into key seats, provide a positive means of transmitting torque between the shaft and hub. That is the basic definition, as I have already explained you in the previous slide. We have three types of keys. This is the front view, and this is the side view. It is a rectangle. It is rectangular parts. Square from the front and the rectangular like this. So it is a side view. Similarly, we have taper key. Taper key is like this. We can have a plane head or jib head. It is called jib head. Or we can have Woodruff key. Parallel, tapered, and Woodruff key. These are three basic types of keys. What is the advantage of tapered key? If we apply force here, it fixes itself between, for example, we have a shaft here, shaft portion, and this is upper portion is hub portion. So it fixes itself between shaft and hub. Because of this force, it exerts force on the hub. Hub and the joint of hub and shaft is tightened up, and at the end it joins the two parts firmly, and after that this hub will not move in this direction at all. But if we put this parallel key or this Woodruff key, there is a possibility that this hub will move in, because at one end we have a support provided by step of shaft, but on the other side it is possible that these parts move. So that's why you have to put retaining ring or clamp cover collars. What clamp collar? You saw collar in this picture. This was the collar. This clamp collar. This is the clamp collar, and this is retaining ring. I will just show actual picture of retaining ring. This is a retaining ring. It is a fastener that snaps into circumferential groove on the shaft or tube from the shoulder. So you have grooves When you put this element here, slide it here, and when it comes here, it snaps itself. Basic example is, it is an example of retaining ring. We fix it like this. Similarly, in the car handle, we have retaining rings. We can just open it with a screwdriver and it fixes itself here firmly. That's why car handle doesn't come out. That is the basic function of retaining ring. So what is the advantage of parallel key? It is the most commonly used key. ANSI, ISO standard key are given in table 10-2. The problem related to this chapter are very, very easy. You just have to understand how to calculate force and how to calculate area. After that, you can just select key from the table. For example, if you have dia of shaft, for example, dia of shaft you calculate is 1 inches. So for 1 inch dia of shaft, you have to use a key of 0.25 inch width. So square key of 0.25, you have 0.25 by 0.25 of key size, and after that you have to calculate length of key. And length of key, if you check on internet, there are a large range of lengths of key which are available. Also, you can put a set screw. I will explain what is a set screw in a couple of slides. A set screw, and in inches system, if you have 15 millimeter system, if you have 15 mm of dia, for 15 mm dia, you can put a key of 5x5 mm cross section. Keys are typically negatively tolerated means if the size of key is, let's say the size of key is 5x5, this is the size of, and we have also the length. So if this dimension is 5x5, most probably its dimension will be 5 plus 0 and minus 0.01. In positive direction, it is impossible that it is more than 5 inches. It is always less than 5 inches or negatively tolerated. And because the slots in which we have to fix this key is 5 plus some other dimension. And by right hand rule, you can select any length of key, but just keep in mind that the length of key should not be more than 1.5 times of the diameter of shaft. For example, here you have a diameter of 1 inches. You can put a key of this size, but the length of key should not be more than 1.5 inches. It can be 0.5, it can be 0.25. Depends on applied torque, but it cannot be more than 1.5 inches. If you calculate that for 1.5 inch of key size, the stresses are huge and you have to increase the cross-section area, or you have to increase cross-section area, there are two possibilities to increase cross-section area. Either you increase this length or size. Both cases, you are increasing this cross-section area. Also, we also know that for 1 inch size, we cannot put a key of larger than 0.25. So what can we do? We can put two keys. Two keys causes the area to increase by a number 2. So as the area is more, stresses will be reduced. So we can put more than one keys at, for example, if this is a circular shaft and we have to put one key here, it is possible that we put second key here or third key here, or 1 and 2 key hairs, and it always depends on the designer. Alternating torque, the term alternating is related to fatigue. As you have not studied fatigue, it is impossible for me to explain you, and also it is impossible for you to learn. So in simple ways, when you apply loading, for example, this is loading. If you have a force of 10 Newton, static load, it means that at any time t, the load applied is 10 kilonewton. This is static load. In case of fatigue, the load changes from, for example, if shaft is rotating, one bearing here and one bearing here. At this point, this force at this point is downward, but after 180 degree, this layer under compression becomes a layer under tension. So it is 180 degree. So at that point, for the same case, the load will be minus 10 kilonewton. So by the time this load is alternating, so we have a load from 10 kilonewton to minus 10 kilonewton. So mean value will be 0, F mean and or F m, and F alternating will be this value. That you will study in fatigue. For time being, just check what is the maximum magnitude on the shaft. This is the maximum magnitude we have to design for this maximum magnitude of force. What happens? Because there is positive and negative compression, due to that on the shaft there is, for example, this portion. Due to this force, this key sometimes move in this direction, sometimes move in this direction. That's this which causes some delay in the motion. That is called backlash. And when this is a case, we can also use set screw. And what is a set screw? This is a basic example of set screw. We have some small screw. We put a collar and we put screw in that collar. Basic example is this. We put a gear on the motor and we put a set screw in that. This set screw fixes itself with the shaft. We have small slot here. And this set screw fixes the collar with the shaft. And we don't have any lag. It depends only on the amount of force. If forces are less, we can put a set screw. For example, in any fan, you will see a set screw. Secondly, we have taper keys. A white width of taper key at given shaft diameter is same as parallel key. Width is same, and the taper key has a taper value. For example, if the size of square key is given, so this dimension will be same, but the back dimension will be a little bit enlarged because of taper. So this line, if let's say it is 1 by 8 inch, it is possible that it is 1 by 8 inch plus 1 by 32 inch, and this dimension is increased by amount 1 by 32. So that is the taper. So how we attach these two components? If we have one shaft, we have made a groove in the shaft, and we have a hub attached to it. We put this key here in between, and we apply force. Due to this force, this key is pressed in the groove, and due to this pressure, this element will move upward and this element will move downward. And what is the disadvantage? Because if we are moving it outward, it is possible that central axis of this shaft move a little bit downward as compared to central axis of the hub. So both, there is a possibility of eccentricity of shaft axis. So that is the only disadvantage. Why we put a jib head? Why we put here? Because if we put jib here, if there is a jib, we can insert some screw or some other components to pull the key out of this joint. That's why we put a jib, because due to jib, we can just easily remove the key. Advantage of Woodruff key. Woodruff is some semicircular key. Let me explain here. It is again, function is same. We have a shaft. In the shaft, we have a semicircular slot. And we put a semicircular key within the slot, and on that slot we put a gear. And because it is semicircular, if there is some misalignment in the motion, due to this misalignment, this key moves within the slot and fixes itself. So if there is some little bit misalignment, Woodruff key is better. It is self-aligning key. What is the disadvantage? Disadvantage is that the taper of shaft is a little, the groove in the shaft is more as compared to main key, and due to this more key, at some point the strength of shaft is decreased further. So if the strength is decreased, to overcome this issue we have to use some larger diameter of shaft for same amount of stresses. So that is a little bit disadvantage of Woodruff key. There are a lot of possible Woodruff keys, but in table 10-3 gives some dimensions of Woodruff key which you can use. For example, what is the meaning of 404? 404 means that physical meaning. The first letter, the first two letters, first two, 04, first two letters divided by 8, and the remaining letters divided by 32. For example, this one. Its size is 12 divided by 32. And 08 divided by 8. So you can just calculate 08 by 8 gives us 1, and 12 by 32 gives us 0.375. So this is the width and length of key. We can just calculate by using this. The first two component divided by 8 and remaining component divided by 32. That's how we calculate this dimension of key. In the problem of shaft, what we do initially, we place the component where we are required, then we design shaft accordingly. Usually on the shaft we have fatigue loading, so we design a shaft considering our fatigue loading, and there are different criteria of fatigue loading that you will study in machine design too. Once you have designed the shaft, then you have to place keys in between the slots, and for designing at the design stage you have to check which type of key you need to insert for specific amount shafts. For that you need to check initially which type of stresses are applied on the key. For example, if there's a key in the shaft, in between shaft and hub, there are two modes of failure. For example, if this is a shaft, this is axial shaft, and this is hub. We have a torque here applied here. From this torque, because torque will be same, from this torque we can calculate force. This will be the force which will be pushing this element here, and this element is further pushing this pink element in this direction. As a resistance, this pink element will apply a resistance in opposite direction. So if we have torque T and this is torque T, these two torques has to be equal. So at the end, this element will rotate by same amount as this. It is possible that due to this load, the key fail in shear. This, if upper part of key slides on the lower part of T, this is a failure due to shear. And for that, we have an equation. Similarly, there is possibility of bearing failure. What is a bearing failure? It is possible that this edge or this edge of key crushes. If it is crushes, it is a failure due to bearing load. And usually we study this because at this point we have higher amount of force, because T is equal to FR. So we calculate force at this point, and due to that force, it is possibility that if this is the area, these are two possibilities. Just this is shear plane and this is bearing plane. And what is the, if you have a key of, let's say, size X by X and length L, what is shear area? Shear area is, this area is shear area, length into X. So this area is length into X. And what is bearing area? Bearing area is this area. And what is X by 2 into L? So bearing area is half of shearing area. when we have failure in shear, we have force divided by area of shear. That tau has to be checked with the tau of the lock key that we are using. That I have already explained how to calculate this area. Fatigue effect. Usually for shear failure we have to check for the fatigue effect, but as you have not studied fatigue, just consider static force divided by area. Fatigue, as I explained, that we have alternating force and mid-range forces. Due to from mid-range forces you get tau mid-range, from alternating you get tau alternating, and from that you have to use some theory to check the sector of safety. Instead of using all that, just check maximum force divided by area will give you tau static, and you have to check that tau with the SSY, shear yielding strength of the key. For bearing failure we have area bearing, that is usually half of shear area. This is interesting thing. Even if you study, even when you will study fatigue, bearing is not a function of fatigue. This will always be static. So in fatigue you will have FA and FM. So F max will be alternating, so that at the end this will give you some static magnitude of force. So in this case, as I have already showed, we will not be using FA on FM, we will be using F. Materials, usually the keys are made of ductile low carbon materials. So try go whenever you are required to select up material, go to table A20 and select from top two or three materials, any material. Check select also some use of soft, they are mostly made of soft material. Key design. Now the basic question is how to design a key. This topic is one of the most easiest topics of machine design one. There are not a lot of variable in key design. The shaft diameter, if you have shaft diameter, you have a range, you have a value of key that you can use. If you have that value, for example, a key has three dimensions. Usually we in the table they have given us square key, so at the end we are left with 1 x and l. So we have only one parameter x. L, you know that l has to be less than 1.5 of diameter of shaft, so that is also limitation. You can increase length up to 1.5 d. the x is given, so only parameter is left is x, and which this x is dependent upon diameter of shaft. We have range of diameter, and for each range we have some value of key that we can use. Because these are design problems, in the paper or in the exam or in the quiz you get a problem to select a key, just go and select a square key, because the problem will be very easy. You just need one dimension, and from that dimension you will get the final answer. I will just explain this thing with a simple example and you will get an idea how we do this. That I have already explained you, that key acts as a fuse. It will fail first and to save shaft and hub. This is one reason to use only soft ductile material for key. What? Because it has to fail. It has to fail in which loading? Shear loading. So if it has to fail in shear loading, the brittle material cannot resist shear. So it has to be ductile. More the ductile, more will the resistance in shear. So we have to use some ductile material. One of the disadvantage of using keyway is that if there it is a assume that it is a shaft We have made a keyway in the shaft. Due to this keyway, there will be stress concentration in the shaft, and this stress concentration will increase localized stresses in the shaft. So what we do, we have some stress concentration factor. For example, if you have value of torque for the shaft, we can calculate tau is equal to Tc by J. If you get a value of, let's say the value of T becomes 100 MPa, we have, and for stress concentration of keys, we have the all the factors given in, I think, table 7 in Shiglen, it's table, I forget, 7-6 or 7-5. We have a lot of factors given. Let's say the factor for stress concentration of key is 2.5. If it is 2.5, we multiply tau with 2.5, it gives us 250 MPa. Even though the actual stress is 100 MPa, due to stress concentration, we use tau equal to 250 MPa, and for these 250 MPa, we will get a larger diameter as compared to 100 MPa. So the factor of safety, the stress concentration, the effect of keyway is already taken care of in the design of shaft that you will study in machine design too. That is the top. Just a simple example, and today's topic will be done. This is a complicated figure. This is taken from book of Norton. In simple words, we have one shaft, this shaft, we have two component, one this component, two component, and we have two bearing. So we have something like this. We have one support. Decreased. One half is attached here. There is a bearing. We are not concerned with bearing. And second gear is a gear bearing is attached. There is another step for bearing, and there is one gear attached here. So in previous examples, they had already calculated dia of this point and dia of this point. There is a torque, magnitude of torque is given. The torque has to be transmitted from this shaft to this element to this element. This gear to this gear, the torque has to be transmitted, and the magnitude of torque is also given, 146 pound inch. So we know torque. We have to place one key here with this hub and one key with this hub. The basic question is to design that key. What is the key we need here? Dia at B, this is point B. Dia at B is 0.75 inches, and dia at D is 0.531 inches. It is already being calculated. As we have not studied shafts yet, so you don't know how to calculate dia, but at this point, just say that we know that these are the dias. 4.75 inch, go to table 10-2, 4.75 inch, we have a key of 0.187 inches. So for this point, for at B, we have key size of 0.187 by 0.187 key. 0.187 by 0.187 size. And at D, we have 0.531 inch dia, 0.531 is in between these two, so we have a key of 0.125. So at D we put another key of size 0.125 and 0.125. So the question reduced to only these two keys. Also we need to calculate force. What is the force? We know the torque, 146 pound inch. We know the dia of B, which is equal to this. We know the torque, which is applied with this value. So what is the maximum force acting? F is equal to T by R. At maximum R, at this outer surface, just divide 146 divided by what is r, 0.75 by 2. We will be getting force at B, and also similarly we get force at D. So just writing from my data that force at B becomes equal to 389.33 pound, and similarly writing values of D here, force at D is equal to 146 divided by 0.266. it gives us the value equal to 5. So we have dias. From those dias we calculated forces on at point B, at B and at we have forces, we have keys, which key we use, we are using here. For this point we have 0.187 by 0.187 size of key, and for this we have 0.125 by 0.125 of size of key. So we have size of key. The third thing is we have to assume one specific length. If we put a key for this cylinder, for example, if we have this size of key, what is the length of key we require? It is required to be assumed. One way is to check for all the values assuming this L as variable, and at the end just calculate what is the minimum possible value of L can be. Another way is to assume some value, just as in book I will assume length is equal to 0.5 for both cases. L is equal to 0.5, assuming this value of length for both cases. What is shear stress? Shear stress is force divided by area. And what is area? Area is 0.187 into 0.5. So 389.33 divided by 0.5 into 0.187. Similarly, tau at D is equal to force at D divided by 0.5 into 0.125. Substituting values will give us shear force here, which is equal to 4160 psi, and for here we get 8780 psi. As the bearing force is the bearing area is half of the shearing area, so bearing stress will be double. So just writing sigma bearing at B equal to force divided by 0.5 length multiplied by this half area, because bearing area will be this half. So it will be 0.5 into 0.187 by 2, or it will be 2 times tau B, or and it will be equal to 8372 psi. Or similarly, sigma bearing for point D is equal to 17562 psi. So we have bearing stress, we have shear stress, we have all the values. What we need? We need some material. I told you that usually these keys are made of softer material. If you go to table A20, just using second material 10-10 cold drawn steel, if you check the value, S yield for cold drawn steel is equal to 42 kpsi. So to calculate factor of safety for this, N at D for shear, we have strength which is equal to 42 into, because it is yielding strength, for it is shear, so we have to multiply it 0.577 divided by 8.78. just calculate and you will get answer. It is around 2.xx. similarly for this value, and for bearing at point D is equal to 42/17.562, which will give us value factor of safety of 2.5. similarly going for this value, factor of safety for shear at point B, we have 42 × 0.577/4160. The final answer will be around 5.9. Or similarly, for this factor of safety, bearing factor of safety at point B, and bearing at point B is equal to 42/8372. The final answer will be 5.26. So this is the answer. If you select a key of length 0.5, and these are the key chosen from the dia already calculated, or in your case known dias, you take a length of key length of 0.5, the factor of safety are 5.9, 5.26, 2.5 and 2. I don't remember the exact value. If these factor of safety are acceptable, you can go with it. If it you want to reduce the factor of safety, just change this value from 0.5 to 0.4. all the values will change and the factor of safety will reduce. Or if you want to increase the diameter, for this value, for this 0.531, the maximum length of shaft that you can key that you can use is 1.5 × 0.5, or almost 0.8 inch. And in this case also you can use almost more than 1 inch of key. So it is possible for you to use longer keys as well. In some cases, if you, for example, if you solve it and you get a maximum length of key here, and at the end the factor of safety is 1, 1.2, 1.3 or say 0.8, you can use multiple keys. By using multiple keys for same length, the keys are more, so there will be we will multiply n. These are the and capital N for number of keys. If you are using 4 keys, the stress is divided by 4, so we are applying lesser amount of stress per key. So this is the only thing that you need to consider while designing a key. So that was all for today's lecture.